So Dr. Schroeder and I go way back, not as far back as some of the people in the room, but working for HSR and organizing Jerusalem fellowships programs for college students who are of the most inquisitive type. Dr. Schroeder really was put up, you know, against the test of knowledge and what's out there, and Baruch Hashem, he's helped a lot of people in their transition from being, say, totally secular towards at least understanding the Torah point of view. So Dr. Schroeder is a scientist with over 30 years of experience in research and teaching. He earned his bachelor's, master's, and doctorate degrees all from MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, with his doctorate thesis being under the supervision of physics professor Rob Lee D. Evans. This was followed by 5 years on the staff of the MIT Physics Department prior to moving to Israel, where he joined the Weizmann Institute of Science and then the Volcani Research Institute, while also having a laboratory at the Hebrew University. His doctorate is in two fields, earth sciences and physics. Dr. Schroeder's formal theological training in biblical, Talmudic, and Kabbalistic interpretation includes 15 years of study under the late Rabbi Herman Pollack, Rabbi Chaim Bravender, and Rabbi Noah Weinberg of blessed memory. The books that he authored are, so far, Genesis and the Big Bang, The Science of God, The Hidden Face of God, and God According to God. That one, I've had you figure that one out, but maybe we'll... Anyway, tonight I won't even begin to explain what he's going to talk about. We all know the title, but I'll leave it up to the doctor.
I know with the weather outside, you must have used your free will somehow to get by what it's saying to you. I'm concerned we're going to knock that off. I appreciate the offer, but I have a feeling it'll end on the floor possibly before.
My attendance here was determined. There was no exercise in free will.
Well, if you... essentially, all of the neurologists with whom I've spoken, that only numbers about four, have agreed with you entirely. That it's a domino effect. Your chemistry sets up you up, and one thing leads to another, and next thing you know, you're putting on filling. Put it that way. So the fact is that, first of all, I think we do have free will, but I think that in the physical world there's no place for free will. Of course, the Torah says, by its definition, but that's it has a vested interest in telling us we have free will because it has halacha and you're supposed to choose to follow the law, etc. So the Torah makes that assumption, and the late Rabbi Noah Weinberg, blessed memory, the founder of Eshet Torah, says that the specific sentence in the Torah about free will is Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 19. I place life and death before you, therefore choose life. It's an explicit statement that you have choice. And the whole point of halacha is you have choice. That you make the name of the game is choice. But for the Torah to claim we have vested interest, obviously, I mean that we have free will is a vested interest in the Torah, because that's the whole nature of biblical religion. The question is, do we have free will actually once you get not using the assumption that we have. That we perceive that we have free will is not a very useful bit of proof, because perceptions can be extremely misleading. I'll just do one at the moment. If everyone will please move your toes, wiggle your toes inside your boots or shoes, or I hope they're not too wet from the puddles outside. Please everyone move their toes. Feel your toes moving? Feel your toes? Feel your toes? Yeah? You feel your toes? Do you feel your toes? Yeah? Where do you feel your toes? Where do you feel your toes?
Right.
No. See, the perception is totally that you feel your toes in your shoes. That's why you can't produce perceptions. The simple fact is toes don't have a mind. There are neurons down there that when you move your toes, those neurons get nerve cells, that can get stimulated. They run the information up a little bit less than 2 meters away to your brain, and in your brain you have about 6 body maps, each one upside down and backwards, but that's the current nature of the eye, forces that in it. And part of one of those body maps is related to your toes. It becomes stimulated and it says my toes are moving. Your entire life takes place in here. nothing takes place outside. Every sense you have, you may feel that your toes are moving in your shoes, and they are moving your shoes, but you feel them up here. Toes have no mind, no, there's this. I'm feeling this in my brain, but I'm sure I'm feeling it in my fingers. So perceptions that we have free will are of zero significance. That you have free will, because there's an example of the total perception, and it's completely wrong. You know, get you to the right place. So in fact, that's pretty much what I, in the discussions that I have with the neurologists, is that free will is a perception. It's a useful perception. It's an empowering perception, but it's a perception nonetheless. Your brain's on the show.
Yes,
and that would be true, except for most of these scientists that with whom we talked, that using pre-quantum physics in the neurology. That's the basic problem. But just jumping directly from the biblical point of view, and then to move forward to some of the science behind it. I apologize for this terrible wound in my ear. I had two pieces. As Dr. Goldenhirsch says, my skin is very fertile ground for skin cancer. Okay, so here, there, and every other place. So I apologize. And Barbara just took the big bandage off, which stuck out, lit my wife, literally out to here. I mean, it's disgusting to see, but I apologize for that. But that's, what can I do? It's not disgusting?
Nothing.
No, disgusts me. But that's your choice. So, a cold sifur shuk nituna, yes, in the Mishnah and the Perkei Avot, everything is foreseen, but free will is given. Sounds like an oxymoron. But there are ways that can work. We know that genes give you a tendency, your genetic makeup, because in identical twins, while they're not totally identical, they do have general patterns that flow together, and so they have the same genes that we know, but they're not identical. The lifestyles are not identical, although the genetic makeup is pretty much, not totally, pretty much identical. So we know that genes give you a tendency, and the Torah says, but you have the power to override those tendencies. So there's, you know, every person wants that their neighbor should have a beautiful house, provided their house themselves is a little bit nicer than the neighbor's, okay? So it leads to things like greed and cheating in business. So the Torah calls cheating in business a toiva. I mean, you can't get worse than a toiva. Ham and eggs on Yom Kippur is not a toiva. It's not good for you, but it's not a toiva. It's not an abomination. But cheating in business is an abomination. It's one of the very few things in the Torah that slavery is an abomination. But the Torah realizes you've got this problem. So it gives you a law and tells you to funnel yourself away from that. So we see the idea that the Torah realizes we have tendencies, but it assumes that the genes do not control you. They give you a push in one direction or another, but they don't control you. Okay, so we have, our genes give us a tendency, but they're not totally controlling. We see that again, I just repeat myself with identical twins. So then, the other aspect would be Hakol Tzifui. If everything is foreseen, so how do we have free will? In other words, if God sees, if the future is known, how do we have free will? And we see that clearly in with Abraham. God says to Abraham, you know, your progeny for 400 years will be slaves and will be hit on the head, have a hard time, and then eventually they'll come out. They'll come out of the of their bondage with a lot of good stuff with coming with them. But you, Abraham, will go to your grave in peace. It's a strange deal to take, actually, but Abraham took it because he could see beyond the curtain, put it that way. So we see that there is a tendency, and that's interesting because it's very similar in this idea of if we have choice or we don't have choice, do accidents happen, don't accidents happen, that the level at which control takes place, and both if we are controlled totally by God, then clearly we don't have free will. Both Maimonides and the Guide for the Perplexed, part 3, chapter about 51 or 52 or 53, and the Ramban, Nachmanides, say that while the control is there, accidents do happen. It's very interesting. The Ramban on Genesis chapter 18, verse 19, God is about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Abraham is walking with him. God says, because I've known Abraham, I'm going to tell him what I'm going to do. Now, it's interesting, the art scroll translation, it's one of the problems of not knowing Hebrew. The art scroll translation says, because I've loved Abraham. Text doesn't say I've loved Abraham, it says I've known Abraham. And the older translations say it explicitly. Dalet ayin means to know. That's the word of God. I've known Abraham. So the Ramban asks this a question, and the Ramban, Maimonides, picks it up also, but not necessarily with this question. The Nachmani says, why does God have to say, because I've known Abraham? Doesn't God know everybody? In other words, the Torah is assumed that there's no thing superfluous in the text. So why does God, because I've known Abraham? And the Ramban answers it very interestingly. God knows people at different levels. And it is the control of God in the lower world is the shomer et aklal, to guard the group. But to individuals, accidents happen. Now, that's very annoying to people, because with the bar mitzvah, bat mitzvah, picture of God, that doesn't happen. But the reality is biblical. The God of the Bible does have accidents happen, because that, my guess is that the Rambam and the Ramban, they both say exactly the same thing, had a pretty good insight into what was happening in the Torah. And the more you allow God into your life, the fewer accidents that will take place. But it's to guard the group, and we see it absolutely explicitly in Deuteronomy chapter 20. In Deuteronomy chapter 20, we're about to go, my wife Barbara calls it, Barbara Silver, great writer, teacher. My sister-in-law is sitting right there. She calls it pre-state Israel. We're about to go up to pre-state Israel in Canaan. And there's going to be a battle. And the battle's going to take place. So God says, don't worry, I'm going to fight for you. You will win. It's an explicit statement. You're going to win. And then Peter, what happens right after that? However, if you built a house and haven't lived in it, go home, lest you die in battle. Someone else lives in it. If you planted a vineyard and haven't eaten the fruits, go home, lest you die in the battle. Someone else will eat it. If you're engaged to a woman you haven't married yet, go home, lest you die in battle. What's this, lest you die in battle? 3 sentences early, I'm told I'm going to win the battle. It's the difference between the group and the individual. The group will win the battle. Well, you and at that group that comes into the pre-state Israel, Canaan, it's a different story. You have to watch your back. It's an explicit demonstration of this idea of God having a goal for the group, but the individuals make their choices and how they live their life. The way I see it is the train leaves the station. You get on it, you don't get on it. That's your own business, but the train leaves the station without you or with you. It's not dependent upon you as an individual, but on the group. So God makes the guarantee for the group, but the individual, both the Ramban say explicitly, you have to watch your back. And the more you allow God in to your life, the fewer accidents will happen. So there is this slack in the system of how God controls, and my opinion obviously is that it's God's choice to run the system this way. We see it explicitly, this idea of God pulling back and allowing choice to take place. At least from the Bible's point of view, from Isaiah chapter 45, verse 7, it's the first blessing that we make, I think in Sephardi also, but in Ashkenazi for certain, after the Bordechu, which starts the formal Shafit service, we say a sentence which lots of people know, right? Yeah, but it says a kol there, but the Isaiah is a ra. Yeah, the Blessed Lord, I form light and I create darkness, I make peace and I create evil. I am the Shem doer of all these things. Now we hope that Isaiah got it right, because essentially all of Judaism is based on that sentence. And it's the first sentence we make, the first blessing we make in the formal service after the Bordechu. It's the definition of creation from God's point of view. I form light and I create darkness. If you are the source of light, just be ordinary light, it's just physical light, and you work darkness, what do you have to do with some of the light? That's not a rhetorical question. What do you have to do with some of the light? Yeah, pull it back, hide it. Simtsum, the contract. I make peace and I create evil. One of God's names is peace, shalom, shleimu. I create peace, and now in the blessing it says, I make peace and I create everything. And the Gemara in Brachot, I think it's the 11th Amud, where it says that, you know, evil that early in the morning, better just say everything. So it changes it. But I form light and I create darkness. I make peace and I create evil. Well, if you're the source of all peace, and you're disharmony, even in the world, you have to pull it back. It's the origin of the concept of tzimtzum. That God pulls back and says, I'm giving you the reins. You know, you run your lives within a constraint, and I will pull back. So that it's tzimtzum means to contract, to pull back. So God pulls back, and each creation is a further tzimtzum. So the first creation, in other words, a lessening of God's oneness. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4. And for anyone who's having a debate, by the way, with non-Jews like Christians, you should point out to them that the disciples ask they say, teach us, what's the most important sentence ever made? It's in Mark. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. It's interesting. The Middle Eastern religions are based totally on that sentence. And that's not that there's one God, that's key to Allah, that there's a oneness in the whole world. And then the first creation shatters that oneness, and you get light and dark and oatmeal and orange juice and, you know, death and life and all the differentiations of that occur. It's like if you looked at white light, there's really no such thing as white light. White light is a mixture of all the other wavelengths that in your brain blend together to make white. That's, you know that by passing white light through a prism. And what do you get? You get this whole rainbow of colors. Because that's really what's in the white light. Our attempt with God is to try to see back behind the prism, before the prism, to the oneness of everything. So that tzimtzum, the first tzimtzum, when God creates the heavens, it shatters the oneness and brings into the world the physical world and all of that. So God pulls back there, gives the physical world a certain slack. Rashi talks about it. I don't want to get into a moment about the level at which consciousness goes, but I urge everyone that has a Rashi, read the Rashi on chapter 1, verse 11, where he compares it with verse 11 and verse 12, and he says in this command that the earth actually rebels against God's word. The earth. Quantum physics would say, we realize that. There's a level of cognition in the world, but that's the first tzimtzum. The second tzimtzum doesn't come, now the first, second creation, because each creation that's tzimtzum, the second creation doesn't come to chapter 1, verse 21, where God creates the animals, and that's the soul of animals, because you got animals already in verse number 20. Don't get hung up on the definitions, they're all guesses of which the animals are. But anyway, it can't be a physical creation. The Ramban, Nachmanides, three times over, in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, tells us three times there's only one physical creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, God creates the heavens, the earth. All of the creations are spiritual. So verse 21, when God creates the animals, has to be a perfect tzimtzum, and what is it? It's the nefesh, the soul of animal life. And then the next creation is in verse 27, where God creates et ha'adam, the Adam. Thank you, Peggy Ketzer, for Hawaii, for that insight. God creates the Adam, and it's a third tzimtzum. So by the time you get to people, you have three tzimtzumim, three contractions. You get to the point that God has given so much free will that guess what? By chapter 4, Cain's murdered Abel. You know what I mean? God has allowed it to happen. Could God have stopped it? Of course God could have stopped it. How do we know this explicitly? Because when God says to Cain, get out of here, Cain gets out. In other words, Cain responds and accepts God's command. So God could have stopped that murder. But that's not the nature of the biblical God. And, you know, the point getting at that God pulls back and pulls back, so we have choice. That's the biblical claim, that we have choice. So where's the free choice if everything's foreseen? So it comes down to the aspect of God being inside and outside of time. This is biblically, but we're going to the scientific part also. That's the idea of being inside and outside of time. This idea of understanding the world from inside, but then time is linear. But if you're outside of time, then the word tomorrow and yesterday has no meaning. It's like igglebee, boggly, and zoogly. Outside of time, tomorrow is a meaningless word. It's all, as they say, he bows my knee. It's simultaneous. But inside of time, tomorrow hasn't happened and yesterday is gone. And just a little example, because it doesn't really fit into our head what it means to be outside of time. But in theory, someone has told me that Rashi says this somewhere, but I've never found it in Rashi, I'm sure it is somewhere, that whenever there's an aspect that is crucial to understanding how God interacts with the world, we will have an example in this world that lets us at least work with it. And that example is energy. The Big Bang didn't produce children, chuck liver, gefilte fish. The Big Bang produced light beams, super powerful light beams, electromagnetic radiation, the fancy word for that. It doesn't matter if you think of string theory or any other theory, the reality is our universe had a beginning, and it started with electromagnetic radiation in one form or another, not solid, light beams. And then Einstein showed how light beams could change form and take on the form of matter. I mean, that in itself is just amazing. We know it can happen, we don't know how it happened. And we know that matter can eventually develop, become alive, and become, get a brain, and then possibly a mind. And that in itself is totally amazing, that everyone, atheist, believer, hallelujah, from the morning to the end, or just, or leave me alone with all that stuff, everyone believes that light beams became alive. That is one of the major problems, of course, that all secular people have. Because that's the only creation. The Big Bang produced energy. It never stopped being energy. It just changed form. I had that cup of water in front of me before. That water, had I drank it before, but that cup of water was filled with water. But when I drank that water, I didn't say, wow, great. It can't be hydrogen and oxygen. I mean, hydrogen and oxygen is great for thirst, blah, 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 blah. Because when you drink water, you're literally drinking hydrogen and oxygen. That's reality. It just doesn't, we call it water. And the parallel being that the energy of the Big Bang didn't disappear and become matter. E equals mc squared does not say E, energy, disappears and becomes M, matter. That's exactly what it does not say. What it says is that energy can change form and take on the form of matter. It remains energy in the form of matter. Just like the water remains hydrogen and oxygen, it never stops being hydrogen and oxygen, it just takes form in being water, and we call it water. The first of the nuclear weapons I worked with, atomic bombs I worked with, was uranium-235 bomb. So that's the kind of stuff that's being made in my background's nuclear physics. In a few thousand kilometers in that direction, I think in that direction, I'm pointing the right direction. And
which direction did you want to point?
Unfortunately,
that's east.
Yeah, east. Yeah, I thought that was east. You know, I mean, it wasn't that when that bomb detonated, it wasn't that uranium-235 metal suddenly changed and became your energy. It was always energy in the form of a metal called uranium-235. Like water is always hydrogen and oxygen. We just call it water. Okay, so that's the reality. That's the reality. So we have this problem of energy becoming alive, but it all starts with energy, light beams, and light beams are outside of time. The example in our world of being outside of time is given to us right at the creation. So I just do a little skit that works for me at least. I wake up in the morning. What I'm getting at now is, how can God know the future if we still have free will? I wake up in the morning, and my seichel, my intelligence or whatever, is having a debate with my neshama. Okay, in fact, who uses a similar, not for this point, but yes, I give this debate between the neshama, my soul, and my seichel. Now, the soul comes right from heaven, knows the whole world more or less, but my seichel, my intellect is going to really impress my neshama, because it went through the school of hard knocks to get it from all those eons of development. And it says, among many things, that you know what? It takes 8 minutes and approximately 15 seconds for the sunlight to reach the earth. Well, the neshama thinks that's patently ridiculous. Why is it ridiculous? Because the neshama realizes that the entire food web, except for a minuscule amount of some microbes, a minuscule amount, is based on photosynthesis, sunlight reaching the earth. Well, the creator would, I mean, you could be a carnivore you wouldn't let a tomato into your house, God forbid, lettuce, but the cow you eat and grew up on grass, which was powered by the sunlight. So my neshama says, that's ridiculous. Why would God put the source of the entire food web for all this life 8 minutes and 15 seconds away? Why didn't God put it right on the earth? No. So the neshama, being completely spiritual, jumps out of my body, leaves me enough neshama so I remain whole. Human takes a neshama watch and zooms up, bingo, zooms up to the sun. Okay, no problem. totally spiritual, it can spat anything, can do whatever it wants. It looks and it says, wow, this is amazing. You know what? In about 5 minutes, there's going to be a transition and of an electron from one level to other. It's going to release a particle of light we call a photon. You should realize that's everything that's going on. I see you, you see me because of this. No one has a clue as how that happens, but we know that it does happen because we can measure it. And that photon's going to come right back into the kitchen. It's going to hit you in the eye. I'm going to go on that photon. You're going to measure how much time it takes, and we're going to see where that's the case. So the Neshama zips back up to the sun, waits 5 minutes, goes by, the photon starts going. The Neshama switches on its photon stopwatch and grabs onto the Neshama stopwatch, grabs onto the photon, doesn't slow it down. At the speed of light, it's heading towards the Earth. Meanwhile, back in the kitchen, I know I got 8 minutes. Why should I waste it? So it's in the morning. I've already been, I'm going to dive in already, so I'll have breakfast. Why not? So I go to the, you know, I usually have like high fiber oatmeal or something, but today, you know, what do I care? I take out the eggs, a couple of poached eggs, because that's fast. And I, you know, cooking them up, and they're going to take a few minutes. I look in the pantry, and wow, there it is, challah from Shabbat. That's great, because you can't toast it on Shabbat, but today I can toast it. It's the morning. You can't beat toasted challah. Ah, except right next to it is cinnamon raisin. That's nirvana. So I put out the toaster, go to the kitchen, and there, right in the kitchen, is a bar of margarine, transfats into the garbage, pull out the butter, slap it on, dunk it, great, oh, got 15 minutes, great. I bench, you know, after that, zoom, the photon arrives in the kitchen, my minute show, it shuts off its stopwatch, and I shut off my stopwatch. I have 8 minutes and 15 seconds on my stopwatch. How much time is on my, how much is on the photon? How much?
No.
Zero.
Zero.
Yeah. Zero. She doesn't fit in her brain. Had that photon been in our kitchen, there's a lot of indication from physics today that in fact what he says is true. Had the photon been in the kitchen, bouncing back and forth between two perfectly reflecting mirrors, and not losing the speed of light ever, it would have seen me decide whether it's challah or cinnamon raisin, whether it's going to be high fiber oatmeal or poached eggs, whether it's going to be butter or margarine. It would see me all those things that took me 8 minutes and 15 seconds to do in zero time. There is no way of getting that into your brain, because you cannot extract, doesn't matter how clever you are, how exotic you are, or how much LSD or whatever people take these days are, you can't extract time from or thoughts. We live in a box where every thought, every dream, every wish we have is in a box of time, space, and matter, things that we cannot think out of. So we can't understand that God knows the future by being outside of time. We have an example in this world of being outside of time. So inside of time, tomorrow hasn't happened. Outside of time, the word tomorrow has no meaning. Tomorrow, outside of tomorrow, is about as meaning as oogly and ziggly, or maybe woggly and boogly and doggly, meaning the sounds, because there's no such thing. Like the song says, there's no tomorrow. It's all simultaneous. So God giving us free will, but everything is foreseen. And everything actually is sufui, not foreseen, everything is seen, that's what it is. Not foreseen, everything is seen. So that does not make it a problem. So now we do have the tzimtzum, we do from the biblical understanding, and also have God's control with the tzimtzum. God's control over the world gives us free will. The difficult, that's lovely theory, but when you wiggle your toes, you're certainly feeling that you're wiggling in your feet, but it's in your brain. The perception that we have free will is meaningless. It just doesn't mean that we have free will, because that's about as meaningful as saying I'm feeling my toes in my dogs in my shoes. You don't. So what indication is there then in the world that there is in fact an act of free will? Simon de la Place in about 1814, I wonder if I have it here. This is like the manuscript of what I hope one day will become a book, and I should have written down where I could find it here. But Simon de la Place made a magnificent theory of determinism. It's a classic, and it was 1814. Okay, the theory of determinism. I'm just looking at my notes here, and I see I had failed to write down the page that it's on among me, so I can't find it. But it goes pretty much like this. He says, if you were able to plot and study every particle in the universe, everyone, we can't, that's our problem, because we're limited. Every atom, every molecule, every bit of radiant energy of the entire universe, and put it into what we would call today a supercomputer. He calls it a great thinking machine. Okay, into a supercomputer. And then you program that computer with the laws of nature. If you had that one sliver of time and the laws of nature, you could predict all of the future and reconstruct all of history. Because the laws of nature are called the laws of nature because they are the laws of nature. They control the world. And that was the catechism. That was the catechism, the understanding of the world for about 100 years that science understood, that science felt, and I'm just, it's such a beautiful statement, but I don't see it, and I didn't make a notice to where it was, so I can't read it to you. Okay, silly me. So, there it was. So obvious. And then, almost exactly 100 years later, about 1915, about just a bit over 100 years later, quantum physics turned the world upside down. And it turned out that the laws of nature do control nature in general, but there's a slack. And that's so common in this idea of the spiritual and the physical having mirrors of one or the other. Spiritual we have, I form light and I create darkness, I make creation, this idea of tzimtzum that God pulls back, okay, and allows a slack in the system. And physically, we've discovered that there's what's called quantum uncertainty, that we wouldn't be able to measure the distribution of every atom and the more energy. Even if we could not because we're sloppy, but we couldn't predict what it would happen. An atom in this room, an atom of air, A-T-O-M, an atom of air, or actually molecule in this air of this room at this temperature, has about 50 million bounces off other atoms every second. So even if you can, even if there's a slight uncertainty, and I'm not talking about chaos here, it's different from chaos. If you had a slight uncertainty in any one of them, by the time you get 5 or 6 seconds later, you could have no idea where that atom is. Okay, just can't do it. So one of the problems in predicting weather is partly chaos, but partly uncertainty, because micro things have macro phenomena at times. The usual answer to this is yes, but there's billions of these taking place. And so they average out. But that's not always the case. The example that I've read about, but it happens to be the case because it's partly the stuff that I do also, but again, when I have more here. You have a Geiger counter. This is kind of like Schrodinger's cat. I'm Schroeder. I look very much like, my wife says I look like Schrodinger. I don't know if you dropped the ING somewhere along the line. So anyway, but this is not Turing's, it's just another example though. I have an atom, a bunch of radioactive atoms in a box, and I have a Geiger counter over here, or a photomultiplier tube, anything that multiplies energy that comes in. I cannot predict, not because, according to quantum physics, now my background is nuclear physics, so I apologize, I'm not a quantum physicist, okay? But according to quantum physics, I cannot predict, because it's not predictable, in which atom will decay at any one time, and even if I could predict the atom, which I can't, which specific atom among the million that are there, I could not predict in what direction the radiation will come off as it decays radioactively. That was one of the things that bothered Einstein for the last two-thirds of his life. The first third of his life, he made all these phenomenal statements with relativity, and he introduced the idea of the quantum, and hence spinning with he and Planck, blocking off the quantum physics, but he couldn't stand at his famous statement, I can't believe that God plays dice with the universe. He was right. God doesn't play dice with the universe, but God lets the universe play dice. That's different. God falls back and allows the universe to play dice. It's the idea of symptom in the physical world as it is a symptom in the spiritual world. So here we have this one subatomic reaction, which the radiation will go off, and then, although it's one subatomic reaction and have gazillions taking place, but one of them will hit the sensor in the Geiger counter, and what will that do? It will trigger a multiplying effect, and the next thing the Geiger counter goes click, a macro event, or turns on an alarm or whatever. Now, if we can build a system that takes a subatomic event, namely radiation coming off, and make it so that it becomes not subatomic in its impact, but macro, in other words, micro becomes macro. I'm pretty sure God could do the same thing, and that may very well be what's going on in our brains as well. In other words, that a neuron fires, but which neuron will fire is not so definitely, is not predictable, put it that way. It's kind of like a grab bag, and you have all the possibilities, the potentials in the bag, but we will never know what the potential is going to come out until you put your hand in the grab bag, pull it out, and look what you've got. That's the nature of not being able to understand the future. In other words, that didn't happen until I pulled my hand out, and I could have picked any one of a dozen. I can't see what I'm bringing inside there. And the same thing would be with the radiation coming out of the Geiger counter. So quantum physics changed the understanding of what Simon de Laplace had said. It's a magnificent statement. I'm so sorry I can't read you exactly, because it is beautiful, beautiful dialogue, beautiful literature, but wrong. So we come now that we have a non-predictably, it's called probabilistic. It is probable that sometime in the next 3 seconds, a radiation will hit the Geiger counter and turn it off. Just from the numbers, it's probable. But where in those next 3 seconds, we can't tell exactly. At the level of subatomic level, it's not that we're clumsy. It doesn't exist till it happens. There's an excellent discussion by Pokinghorn. He's an Anglican priest that was previously a very well-known quantum physicist, and he realized that quantum physics just drags about to theology like that. You can't get out of it. And he uses this as an example. It's not a limitation that we can't know, or maybe that even God doesn't know inside of time. It's not a limitation. It hasn't happened. Outside of time, of course, it's happened already. But inside of time, it hasn't happened. So we have a problem. Because now the world's not deterministic. It's probabilistic. Probably sometime in the next 3 seconds, that Geiger counter is going to fire. But where in the next 3 seconds, we can't tell. There's no way of measuring. So that's almost no better than it's better than being deterministic. But it's not free will, because now it's probabilistic. So you have in your brain an idea of whether you're going to put your hands on a piece of wood like this, or whether you're going to put your hands like this, and all those options are there. Now, do you choose which one you're going to do, or is it pre-programmed from your example? I give an example from my own example. But anyway, one thing led to another, and here I am today. So, and the neurologists say, well, of course, that was just like a set of dumb. It had to do because my research was done at MIT, so I have and partly had to do with oceanography, etc., and partly with nuclear physics, tracking nuclear submarines. Okay, mm-hmm. So we're having a review by the top brass of the Navy, which is funding half of it. The other is the CIA, that's funding the other half. But it's at MIT. CIA takes place down in Washington. That's like a story out of a movie. But this is interesting. So we go through the whole stuff, the presenting, and then we have lunch. And lunch isn't random when you have these people with all this metal up here and all this stuff here. It's designed to make friends so you get better funding next year. So MIT presenter, and there are many, I was just one of the presenting, is here on either side a Navy person, and directly opposite you is a Navy person. This is at a private dining room at the faculty club at MIT. Okay? It goes back about the time that only some of us were on it, but I don't think any of us are on it. In any event, so being oceanography and water and it's Navy, so what would be the first course? Obviously, shrimp cocktail. It's the sauce, those that haven't had it, it's the sauce that makes it good. But in any event, so you get this shrimp cocktail, it's just gorgeous, and you have six of them hanging on the plate, and this big red thing there, and I'm chugging away at this, and of course, there's this Navy person. And then I notice, off to my, directly opposite me, but once he off to the left, but that would make her an MIT person, is Regina Bukowski. She never knew that she had this influence on my life until about 30 years after it happened. Doesn't matter. Just this, she's a woman that's in grad school at MIT also. She was a European, she's an Israeli, spent many years helping Holocaust survivors remake their lives, and she wanted to be a scientist, and she made it to MIT grad school. So dumb she wasn't. Okay, and she's sitting there, and I'm eating the shrimp, and I notice Regina has a mixed green salad. And what's going on here? You know, this stuff is delicious. She doesn't realize it. And then it suddenly hit me. Unless it has fins and scales in the water, you don't eat it. And to take much meat biology, of which I've had very little, because I was physical biology, physical motionography. Shrimp don't have fins and scales. So I put my fork down. I'm three through the sixth. The other three are hanging on there. The sailor opposite me, Navy, or Admiral, or whatever he was, you're not going to finish them? Mm-hmm. Now, I could feel that he wanted me to pass them over to him. I could feel it. Barbara Paul's like, he was tussling. But it was such a formal meal that he didn't dare do it. And I said, no, and I put down my fork. Now, I don't know why I did that. See, that's my question. Why did I do that? Why should that interest me that Regina can't figure out that shrimp tastes better than lettuce? Mm-hmm. And it all goes back to my Kiev-born grandmother on my mother's side, Grandma Hannah. And I never thought she was wrong by being strictly orthodox, etc. But it wasn't, and not wrong, it just wasn't relevant to me. I'm a scientist. Or, you know, that's not that that's silly, it's just not a different life. So the question is, and why did I put down my fork? That's the question, why did I put down my fork? And I discussed this, I said, with four neurologists, they all say the same thing. It was dominoes. It was waiting in the wing to happen. You hit the trigger, softer, Hana, bing, 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 down goes the fork. It was just completely out of control. And they're convinced about this. They are absolutely certain. But are they right? Because that would mean then you don't have free will. Then it wasn't my choice to put down the fork. It was my late Hana, my late softer Hana that did it to me. Thank you, I appreciate it, but I'd like to give you the full credit, but I want to think I had a little bit to do with it also, but maybe not. So what's the problem? The problem is there any indication that we have any part of our living outside of our body, metaphysical? Obviously the Bible says so, but do we have any physical indications that there's a metaphysical aspect to our body? If you look at the studies of how the brain works, it's very interesting. Your head, your brain, is designed to keep you alive. It has all kind of antennas in it, or receivers from the antennas that tell you what's going on outside. I wiggle my toes, and this part up here, those nerves of my antenna saying your toes are being wiggled. If you stub your toe, then you can put a painkiller in. That's why painkillers work. It stops the information from your toe, which in theory, if it could feel, it would say, you smashed it, but it never gets up here because the painkiller stops the information from getting up there. So that's the same for everything in your body. It all takes place in every bit of your life. So I know that they have these antennas called eyes, that there are rays out here called light waves, but they're not light. I mean, if they were light, the air would be glowing. And guess what? The light is not glowing. The glowing takes place after it hits your eyes. That's a whole discussion. It's relevant, but not directly germane to what I'm talking about. So only when these light waves hit your eyes, then you experience or perceive what you perceive as light. So I know that light waves exist out here, but I also know that even in open brain surgery before, but now you can actually stimulate it as well, closed brain, you can stimulate this part of the brain, which is called the visual cortex, and in a pitch black room, you will see light. You jump out of bed, the baby's crying, you run over to the room, but you forgot to shut the door, bang, you hit your head, and you see stars, because the nerves in your retina get triggered, and they're good soldiers, so they assume, the good soldiers assume that they're, you know, these neurons, that there's light there, because they got stimulated, and what do they know? And they send the information back here, stars. So I know out here there's things called light waves, they do exist, I can make a machine to measure them, and I know I have an antenna that I can stimulate and trick, and hallucinate that there's light. The same is with sound. The room can be completely silent, but you can stimulate this side or this part in the auditory lobes, and you know what happened? You will hear sound even though it's silent. But we also know that out here, if you clap your hands, molecules start moving, but they're not noise in themselves, or the air would be booming. And guess what? It's not booming. Okay? So we know that there are things called sound waves. They're not sound, But the molecule's bouncing, and when they hit your eardrum, the eardrum moves. Biochemistry, very well known, and you hear sound. Now, there's no understanding where that sound is. In other words, the input is well known. It's the replay that's the problem. There's no sound in your brain. There's no light in your brain. But you perceive light, and you hear sound. But these sound waves are not sound because, again, it's not booming. It's just, you know, quiet. So we have every place in our, every aspect in our input we have in our head is there to measure things outside the world. I stimulate some nerves here. I say, hey, Barbara, you got just too much garlic in the food tonight. There's no garlic in the room at all, but I can trick the brain to think there's garlic. On the other hand, I know very well there are molecules out here coming from a herb called garlic, and they do, those molecules, I can measure them with a machine. So what I'm seeing here is very interesting to me. Maybe boring you, but it's interesting to me, is that the brain picks up things that actually exist outside. The light waves exist outside. They really do. I can measure them. I don't need an eyeball to see it. I can put up a photoelectric machine and it will pick them up. The sound waves exist. I don't need my ears to. I can put a machine that's a recorder and it will record the phenomena. It won't be sound until I hear it, but it can be before the phenomena, these moving molecules. I can make a machine that measures molecules that come of garlic, and I know they exist outside, but I can trick my brain to think that they're there, all these hallucinations. Every place in your brain that can be stimulated relates to something that gives you a sensation or a hallucination, whatever word you want to use, that exists outside your body. And then Olaf Blank, a neurologist from Scandinavia, was just here at the conference, the Brain Mind Conference, BLANKE, you might want to look him up, does a study, and he finds the most amazing thing, so amazing that the first publication of it was in the journal Nature. If you're not in the sciences, then you don't realize. There are two top-of-the-mountain journals in the world, peer-reviewed, top-of-the-mountain. One is called Science. It's published in the States, United States, and one is called Nature. It's published in the UK. And usually people working in the biology use the UK. I use Science because mine was physical work. But Olaf Blank publishes in Nature, and to get that published, you realize the level of peer review. But he discovers a part in the brain that when you stimulate it, you feel you outside of you. Now that's pretty amazing, because you see, every other place that I stimulate in the brain, I hallucinate that it's really there. I stimulate a part of the brain here, it's pitch black, but I hallucinate light, because light waves do exist and the brain isn't crazy. I stimulate over here and I hear sound, but it's completely silent. But the brain's not crazy, because there is stuff out here, and this just identifies the antenna of how it gets in, etc. The olfactory nerve, etc. for the garlic, etc., all of them, touch, etc. Every place in the brain that you stimulate, relate, and you get the sensation actually can be proven to exist outside of you. Up to there, it's not a problem because they actually physically exist. Now, I assure you, Olaf Blank that publishes, and now it's been replicated by many, many scientists, okay, so it's not like, Olaf Blank does not argue for or against, because I've written to him and I tried to meet him, but we never had a dialogue, but I read his papers. Olaf Blank never says the following, okay? It is he that discovered it, and I can mention the names, so I can just quickly find the page here. Roberta Sachs at MIT, and just like, okay, the names are not in my head. Oh, the late Oliver Sachs. One is S-A-X, Rebecca Tech, and Oliver Sachs, not related to the chief rabbi. He just died about a year or so ago. Mm-hmm. All observe and see this phenomena. They do not say what it is. But if you take inductive reasoning, which is essentially, except for the hallelujah experience of where did I get that idea, almost all scientific discoveries or advances are by inductive reasoning. I drop this, it falls down. I pour this, it pours down. I drop the feather, it pours down. Oh, matter attracts matter, gravity. In other words, you repeat the experiment any time and you find something that's common in the experiment. It's called inductive reasoning, and it's the basis for 99% of the discoveries. The 1% are the geniuses like Einstein that make a leap, okay? But his discoveries are based totally on the observations of Michelson and Morley at Chicago 10 years before his discovery. They just didn't take it the next. They measured the fact that the speed of light was constant in every direction, which is mind-boggling itself. But Einstein took it the next step and leaped, made the leap to form the laws of relativity. Every place that we measure, whether it's sound, whether it's light, whether it's garlic, whether it's touch, that we have in the brain also exists outside. If I'm going to be faithful to inductive reasoning, then I have to assume that what Olaf Blanc and many others now have found, when I touch this antenna in my brain and I see myself outside of me, I have to assume that if my inductive reasoning is correct, that I also exist outside of me. It would be the metaphysical me. The metaphysical me, now I make it clear, Blanc doesn't say this case, Sachs at MIT doesn't say this, Oliver Saxton didn't say it, etc. But they all acknowledge that it exists. Okay, they all acknowledge, but they're stuck with the fact that what would it be? It's the same as stimulating, in fact, a near-death experience. Okay, the near-death experience is essentially this. But the difficulty with near-death experience is I wouldn't use that as evidence towards this, because the brain is so stressed in a near-death experience, they don't really know what's going on. But these other measurements are done either in open brain surgery or closed brain, because we now know. The neurologists know how to stimulate these parts of the brain without digging into the brain. So inductive reasoning tells me that, in fact, they call it the shadow person, that the shadow person really does exist. And if this is the case, that's the source of free will. Because in the physical world, if we are totally physical, I mean, I realize the Bible doesn't say, I'm trying to get from the science point of view. In the physical world, from the science point of view, the evidence is that we have a part of ourselves outside of ourselves. As they say, they call the shadow person. You can call it whatever you want. You want to call it your mind. I would rather call it mind. That mind would be metaphysical. And that's right. What would it mean would then that free will and eternal life would be totally connected. Connected in the sense that if you have a radio, like the body, call the body the radio. And there's radios out, radio waves out here that the body, that the radio picks up and changes into music, talk, whatever it is. Smash the radio, doesn't affect the radio waves. Just the radio doesn't hear them any longer. That would be the exact parallel between the body and the mind. That death would mark the end of the body's participation in life. In other words, death would mark the end of the body's participation in life, in ongoing life. Because the mind is not shackled to the brain. The mind is independent. And therefore, the way the mind would be able to work, it would use, well, it's very interesting because I just realized right now, John Eccles, this is Nobel laureate neurophysiologist, I haven't been here, but I never realized the relationship. The mind uses the brain as an instrument to think. He didn't take back his Nobel Prize when he made that sentence. What it's saying is that the mind has to use a library of information. It knows bigger things, being the Shema. But in this world, what the mind knows is what you got inside your brain. Okay? And the mind will work with that and then let you make your decision. And not being physical, it's not limited either by determinism or by probability. It's completely independent. And so that would be then the source of our... That as I see, is really the only evidence that we do have a free will. And just look at one quote piece. It says Erwin Schrödinger, the Nobel laureate, makes this a perfect statement, and he says we do not, I can't believe like all these notes I make about the two things I wanted. We do not live in this world. The reason that we think this is Nobel laureate Erwin Schrödinger, the second person to get the Nobel Prize in the physics that allows your iPhone to work. Don't think quantum physics is some esoteric whatever it is. The only reason your iPhone works, your smartphone works, and your shellac works, it opens whatever it opens up, is because quantum physics got it right. It's totally embedded in quantum physics, okay? Erwin Schrödinger writes, we have a Schrödinger. Oh, wait, I have it here, I think. Because it's such a nice statement, I would like to just read exactly what he does say, and then we can question the arguments or whatever. No, I don't see it here. Okay. We do not... We do not, so in brief, oh, I beg your pardon, I'm quoting Heisenberg. No, it's Schrodinger. Yeah, it's okay. It's Schrodinger. So in brief, we do not belong to this material world that science constructs for us. We, the awareness of our being, each of an individual self, are not part of it. We are outside. We are only spectators. The reason why we believe that we are in this physical picture, that we belong to the picture, is that our bodies are in the picture, and this is the only way of our communicating with them. The we is not the we we think it is. I remember it was really crazy, but I got invited to give the keynote speech at one of the National Prayer Breakfast. 3,000 people attend the entire Congress, including the late president, the former President Obama, who is a phenomenal speaker, regardless of what he says, he's phenomenal. And because I was giving this speech, I was like one table away from him. One table away from him, so I was really seeing him. There's a lot of nuances, but in any event, so the founder of this, the National Prayer Breakfast, that occurs in the first Thursday of February every year, Dave Cox is the person that worked, doesn't matter, his father, Doug Cox. I walk in, and he's a man probably in his 90s, and he says, he grabs me by the arm, and it was embarrassing because this is in a private room before the luncheon. There's a bunch of ambassadors there also, because these are the people that really make the world. You know, it's the level underneath that you never see. Like when I thanked being invited, I wasn't allowed to say any of their names. I didn't say thank you, Senator. I had to say thank you, Senator so-and-so. I never met the senator. He had nothing to do with it, but he was, you know, a name that had me. Cups grabs me by the hand, and he says, Jerry, tell me something, because this is the second time I met him, the second breakfast. Tell me something. I said, something came out of my head. I don't know if I can say it again. The you that is truly you is not the you you think is you. That's what it is. The you that is truly you is not the you you think is you. And that's exactly what Schrodinger says. We're not in the picture. And inductive reasoning says that this shadow person, which all the persons that I've met, or not met, but read all of their writings about it, say yes, the shadow person is a phenomena, but it's a hallucination because you can trigger your brain. But so is the light in a dark room, a hallucination. So is the sound in a soundless room, an hallucination. So is the garlic in the garlic-free room, a hallucination. Obviously, when you stimulate your brain, it's not there. It's forcing you to hallucinate. The brain doesn't know it's hallucinating. But the idea that this, because the brain, why would the brain have maintained this antenna for this, with this specific part of the brain? It's on this side and this side. It's not the pineal gland that people think. It's on this side. Why would the brain have retained it? It's well known by the same people. Roberta Sachs in Texas at MIT is the perfect example. She works with people, like, God forbid, a child is born with no eye. You know, it happens. They're blind. But this part, the visual cortex is completely fine. Or, God forbid, this is a person like a soldier, boom, and the front of the face is completely scorched, and this stuff's getting any information. But the visual cortex is fine. Within 4 years, the visual cortex becomes devoted to sound. That's why, apparently, blind people are more sensitive to sound, because the brain is aggressive. If you have a part of the brain that is not being used, other neurons take it over. Our brain, it's done with cats, unfortunately, where a baby cat is kept blindfolded and it's blind for life. Even though you take I don't know how long you have to keep it blinded, but because those nerves that are forming are redirected. You see that with a phantom limb, God forbid, a person loses the limb, the brain still remembers it for a while. But after a while, that part that is no longer getting a stimulation is taken over by something else. But the most specific example is by Roberta Katz. The fact Sachs, because she's 100% materialist, Jewish, needless to say. Mm-hmm. You know, so that, and she's said point blank that the brain would take these things over. So if the shadow person didn't really exist, then the antenna for that shadow person would be taken over by something that's useful. Why would the brain's aggressive? It doesn't waste space. And that's the whole work that I think it's called the encore, where they discovered all those nucleotides that were thought not to be useful because they're not inside genes, turn out to be very useful. It's not junk.
That's an alternate to your inductive argument.
What
you just mentioned now is a different idea than the induction.
Well, the induction, I'm just saying, first of all, by induction, it really exists, and if it didn't exist, the brain would have taken over that antenna and made it something else. But it does exist. That antenna does exist, and it's not just in these few patients. It's been replicated, I don't know how many times, I'm not going to say hundreds of times, but it's been replicated so that there's a whole list of scientists that if I could find the page, I'd give you the names. So the good news is we got free will. God has tipped to him and pulls back from this. Theological point of view, we have free will, we see it right away. The fact that you feel you have free will has nothing to do with free will, because you still feel your toes. I'm losing my toes right now, and I'm sure I'm feeling them in my feet. But I know, intellectually, I'm not feeling them in my feet. I'm feeling them 2 meters away, in my head. So the perception that we have free will happens to be true, but it's not based on the perception that we have free will. The Bible makes the claim, and science comes to confirm it. If you take this thesis, you should understand what you hear here right now is not something that is out on the street in general. It's an idea, which I think happens to be true. And if it's true, then good for me. I found that out. thanks for all our playing. So we have time for questions. What's the situation? I see a couple of hands. I see a hand here and a hand there. Yeah. I can't ask Charlotte first because of the yes. Pardon for pointing.
So, you're saying that you have some way of reasoning that there is a me outside the physical me. How do you jump the free will from there? You said that that's not within any deterministic world.
Oh, I can't prove it, but it's not physical. There is a
non-physical aspect to you assuming, like the old mind-body parallel, they assumed there was a mind forever.
You're correct.
And yet they never saw that as a violation of mechanical physics.
Oh, Descartes did. Descartes was the one that, and the statement that the duality of mind-brain is dead is about as logical as saying that the duality of the world is dead. But everyone knows that the world has energy and matter. The world is totally dualistic. It's totally dualistic. So the idea that we would be dualistic also fits the pattern exactly. Matter, energy. What are the other dualities? But in any event, I'm not pulling that out of my head. Yes, you are right. I am making a leap that the part outside of you, which is totally not physical, we can't measure it. I can measure a rainbow. I can make that white light look yellow, green, and blue, and everything. But I can't. The only
could well be an artifact.
Big pardon?
It could well be an artifact or a correlate of physical reality without introducing.
There's no question that it could be. But what makes me think not is that for a century we've been told by neurologists that we don't have free will. It's either determinist or probabilistic. But the Bible's always been saying we have it. And then the fact that we find this correlate, which you're using your word, that seems to confirm that we have a part of us outside of us, makes me think that part of outside of us is what the Bible's been saying. Because the Bible has a good track record. Come next week, I'll be told the age of the universe, it's spot on. Six 24-hour days, according to Rashi. Kamoshesh
me'avodah. There's a biblical quote, by the way, from a linguistic point of view.
Say it again, please.
In Hebrew, there is no distinction between the should and the will. So that when it says, you shall choose life, you can translate it as you will. Choose life.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily imply that it's a command. It's more like in the army.
B'v'charta. Oh, you will choose. B'v'charta. Yeah. Okay. You can say it as a statement. But then we do know that if is constant. If you do this, then you get the land. There's one place within one page of Hebrew pride, four times it says, if you do this. And it says the only reason you get this land is because Abraham did it. The late David Harkin said it absolutely perfectly. God fell in love, it says time and again, the only reason we're getting this land is two reasons. God fell in love with Israel, God fell in love with Abraham, God fell in love with Abraham, and got stuck with his grandchildren. That is, by the way, if you read Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 26 and verse 27, will knock you on your feet, because God says point blank, I would have wiped you off the face of the ground, but I can't do it, because the nations of the world will say that they did it. We're here. We are here for one reason only, not to fast on Yom Kippur. We're here for one reason only. Then God wants the nations of the world to know that there's a God, and we're God's marker. God made a gamble. I think it's 3,500 years ago, but some people say 3,300 years ago. That we will be a marker in this world. It's explicit. It's not a gamble. And no, guess what? The Jews are markers in this world. There's just no way getting around it. I mean, even forget the history, which Kent Spear is a great history. Kent Spear is history of the Jews, or why the Jews. But just take right now. Take our slice of time. The entire communications industry is based on Jewish brains. The internet, there's one name it's not like a whole 50 people. There's one person who is attributed with the founding of the internet. What's his name? Leonard Kleinrock. Look him up. Leonard Kleinrock. Four people get the IEEE award. He's one of them. But his paper in the early 1960s describing how the internet could work founded the internet. And then there's Waze, and there's Google, and there's Facebook, and there's WhatsApp, etc., etc. All the other things are spin-offs. They're totally Jewish brains. You know, it's not that we're better or worse, because that's what Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 26 makes very clear. But we are different. That's why Kodesh doesn't mean super duper. Kodesh means separate. Right? Doesn't mean you're better, it just means we're separate. God said we will stand out, and we will stand out. Read the history of the Jews in the Middle Ages by a Reverend something, William Parks. And he talks about what it was like to be Jew, and he's Christian. But the great thing about that book is every page has this much of text and this much of references, and they stood out for all the time, usually being hit on the head, etc. But for all the time, there was something special, but now it's clear. It's not, you know, I don't have to go back to Sinai, which most people think never happened in any event.
It was James Parks.
Huh?
James Parks.
I can't hear you.
His name was James Parks. James Fox.
Oh, William, James Fox, you sure?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah? You know, it's a phenomenal book. It's really something. He's buried in Jerusalem somewhere, if we're talking about the same person. But in any event, what are we getting at? Well, the Bible makes certain claims. They turn out to be true. So the Bible claims that we also have free will. I'm willing to fly with it. Mm-hmm. You know, let me just... Okay, but now wait, no short.
It's a similar question. I still don't see how that proves that we have free will.
It opens the door for it. If it doesn't exist, you don't have free will. In the physical world, there's no place for free will. It's either probabilistic or deterministic. Then suddenly we find a being outside of us that relates to us, and we can stimulate it. So now I have to assume that it really exists. Now, whether you're going to say that's independent from the laws of physics, it's not physical. This mind that's outside the body isn't physical. So if it's not physical, if it's physical, I can measure it. So it's not physical, it's metaphysical. So if I can't measure it, that means it's not in the physical. So I would assume that it's not bounded by quantum physics or deterministic classical physics, you know, classical physics. I would assume it's not bounded by that, which would mean then it's independent. So how would it work? Your brain has a library of... I'm going to call it the mind. Works with the library that's in your brain. You put garbage in, and your mind's going to get garbage out. You know, as Louis Pasteur said, chance favors the prepared mind. And Marshall McLuhan says it perfectly. If I hadn't wanted it, I wouldn't have seen it. It's exactly what you say in the Shema. Don't go after my... Go after what? Look at the order. After my heart. It should be the opposite. You should go after your eyes, and then after your heart. You see it and you want it. But McLuhan had it right. If I hadn't wanted it, I wouldn't have seen it. In other words, if I hadn't already wanted it, I wouldn't have noticed. Suddenly you're about to buy a car, and what happens to every car on the street? It'll become interesting to you, because you wanted that. So the order is that you wanted it, and then you saw it. Well, I'm just talking around the issue. So I think the indication is that, because the Bible claims we had it, and now we find something that indicates that we might have it, and it's metaphysical for sure, because otherwise you can measure it. You can't. So I would say that, but this man had his hand up. And again, I have to make it very clear. It's
you drew a distinction between uncertainty and chaos or randomness.
Hmm.
So can you is one micro and one macro, or
chaos is it's a mixture of the two, but it's because the example that I just gave with John Pogging, who actually pointed out that every molecule in the air is having 50 million in 1 second, 1,001. Try to count to 50 million in that amount of time. Every molecule that's around you has had that many interactions. So the fact that if it's off a tiny bit, you can't predict it. So it's a mixture. Chaos and unpredictability are a mixture of the motion of a molecule is so intimate, and there's so much taking place that by 2 weeks you can't tell if it's going to be a hurricane or a sunny day at the beach.
Is the difference one of magnitude between chaos and unpredictability?
I don't want, you know, the answer to that question for me is on page, on the fourth daf of Brachot. Teach your tongue to say, I don't know. I wish I had that in my head, not the NSA when I was giving a talk. Wait, I don't know the order. Wait, I think you had your hand up there.
Is this shadow person that you're referring to, is this inside of time or outside of time?
I have no idea. My guess is it's, for what, dealing with us, it's inside of time, but it's not bounded by time. So when the body dies, it does not necessarily die, which would make eternal life and free will totally intertwined.
So this is where you would make the connection between what's divine within us? Is this what you would do?
I think it's all what's divine within us. Well, I think it's all divine because we're created. We're all created by
this. There's a physicality of us, and there's the part that's supposed to live on after us.
Oh, that would be separate. That would be the mind.
Is this the part that is outside of time?
It's outside of the physical world. I don't know if it's outside of time. Because it deals with inside of time.
Nefesh, ruach, neshama, chaya,
v'yakida. Yeah, that's all since inside biblical thought. So I'm just trying to give you the science point of view.
Can I just make a plug real quick? So Sunday there's a second part on reincarnation. I really think that's Winston. Maybe we'll touch on that anyway.
Yeah. Oh, wait, I don't know. I have several, a woman at this point. And then, back to you.
I wonder, address that, what you call the shadow parts?
Well, it's called by the skeptics that do not believe it exists,
well,
called.
I would really
disagree
with that. First of all, that
name shadow. Could
you
that more loud?
I want to share that I had a kind of near-death experience. It was a drowning experience, and I left the physical body, so it was kind of maybe that part of my brain, who knows, that was maybe tapped to experience myself as more of who I am.
Well, unless what you...
The experience, it was what you call mind, but for me, I call it consciousness. It was pure consciousness. Awareness.
And awareness of what?
I'll tell you. I was not my body. There was no identification with my physical body at all. Nor was I identified with as a female, or as a girlfriend, or as a daughter, or as any label. I was nothing other than pure consciousness. And the experience I was blessed with in that state was kind of what I call the divine attribute of peace, and my consciousness fused as one. It was being peace. It was nothing but beingness, and the attribute of what I experienced was of peace.
Were you time bound?
What?
Were you divine bound?
No, there was no time. There was totally no light. In fact, it was like I was experiencing a kind of a void. A total void of nothingness, and yet within the nothingness was the allness.
Was the allness? All? ALMs?
It was like ALM. Nothingness and allness, because it was all, but there was nothing that I was, it was just beingness.
Yeah. So why would you think that's not outside your consciousness? Why would you think that's not outside your body?
There was no connection to the body.
That's what I'm saying.
No, but she doesn't like shadow. Shadow and body.
I and consciousness were when I was no longer in a physical body.
So you're thinking like shadow, like a physical shadow? Or so, is that the problem? Because I've also interviewed four people, now you make it number five, here in this state, that have had these experiences. They all say something very similar to yours, not exactly. two of them said that they met their deceased mother, and the mother said, it's not time, dear, go back. Two of them.
Well, I didn't mean, because it was a void, there was nothing. Yeah. It was just pure voidness, maybe being the beginning of it. So I'm not quite sure myself what that plane was where I was being.
Yeah.
But it wasn't my time to pass on, and at a certain point of experiencing that conscious of being, peace, or whatever, it was just pure consciousness, I was knocked back, like my hand apparently hit the bottom of the water, underneath the water, and I got catapulted back into my body. Because it wasn't my time to pass on.
Yeah.
And the first thing that came into my body consciousness was, oh my God, the body's so heavy. That was the first thing. And the second was, oh my God, I'm in this water. It's like if that's bottom, that must be up. And my rationalogical consciousness came in at that point.
Okay.
But in the other, nothing of that.
That's very similar to what I'm talking about, this idea of when I use the word shadow, I'm not saying a physical shadow. That's the word they use. That's the word that Oliver Sacks used. That's the word that Mike Schwarmer used, who's the head of the Jewish Native, say the World Skeptic Society, the founder and head of it. So you realize his position, and still they accept the fact of this. They call it the shadow person, but it's not like a shadow. It's not like it's just you outside of you. It's like what Schrodinger says.
Right.
The reason we think we're in the picture, because that's the only way. I got this email from a man whose father had the experience. He's a complete atheist. He remained an atheist. He said, but when he was sorry, he saw his body on the ground, and he said, I don't want to get back in that old overcoat. Those were his words when he came back to life. And there's a book by Dr. Alexander that people have talked about. What's it called, Dr. Alexander? Famous. It was on the best of
proof of afterlife.
Oh proof of heaven. Many people have. Now, Mike Schwarmer, as I just mentioned, who calls it the shadow person, wrote an article trying to shoot down that art, and he called it proof of hallucination. Because you don't know with the near death experience, it could be just you come back online. His claim is all dumps. It's all, you know, you've all been all these. I agree with you. I think he's wrong, and.
Can I just say, notice one thing, even though they use that terminology, and maybe it's not acceptable for us, but if, on a certain level, when we talk about what Noah Weinberg mentions, what is Tselem Elohim? It's free will. It's the ability to make that choice, the choices. So even the word Tselem means shadow.
It's
not so far. That's the best word they can come up with.
I like that so much. I'll get to one second, but I want to just point, but I want to say that this might exist throughout all of existence. Hence Rashi talks about the earth rebelling in his commentary, Genesis chapter 1, verse 11. It's really worth saying. Also, just lest I forget, there's a video that we made called Proof of God in 5 Minutes. Please, has over 4 million views, shot at MIT, shot at Eshet Torah, no script whatsoever, shot it 3 times, no script. First time took 7 minutes, second time 6 minutes. By 5 minutes and 28 seconds, we thought we weren't lying. Proof of God in 5 minutes. There is no use of biblical information. It is totally based on NASA. The description of the universe brought by NASA is spot on with the description of the creation of the universe as brought by the Torah. It's called Proof of God in 5 minutes. You don't get 4 million views if you're on something called Proof of God in 5 minutes. If it's not accepted, and just let it go at that. If you have a chance, you just go to go to Google. You type it in, it comes right up. Usually. So I'm just because what am I getting at? Anyway, the world. Oh, but what I wanted to say before that, the essence of all of this, that there's something totally spiritual, not physical, would have been certain, and everyone would accept it if we hadn't gotten stuck with the Septuagint's translation of the Hebrew Bereshit bara Elokim et haShamayim v'et haAretz, and it writes in the beginning God created the heavens in Greek, of course. I don't know Greek, but Professor Danny Schwartz knows Greek and biblical everything other. And I asked him, is the Septuagint really saying that? And it says, yeah, the Septuagint says, in the beginning God made the heavens and the earth, actually. I'm just trying to make this rather bizarre statement that you'll find. The opening sentence of the Bible, according to Rashi, has no form of beginning in it whatsoever, not with a beginning, by a beginning, from a beginning, with a beginning, by a beginning, etc. It doesn't exist. Read the Rashi with an open mind. Rashi says point blank, for example, the Septuagint, in the beginning God created the heavens and earth, as Rashi points out, in Hebrew, it wouldn't be Bereshit Bara, would it? It'd be Bereshona Bara, but the text says Bereshit. So the Rashi has a whole take of this, on all the forms that you might say, and he says the only way you're going to understand this is to go to Proverb number 8. He sends us to Proverb number 8. I learned this first from the Ramban, okay? So I want to give it in his name. I have in the science of God. The Ramban, Nachmanides, writes, if you will merit and understand, and of course you know you're shot down right there, but if you will merit and understand the secret of the first word, Bereshit, you will know why the Jerusalem translation, it's 1900 years old, not the Jerusalem Talmud, the Jerusalem translation, a Targum Yushami, the Jerusalem translation is Bahachmata Barai Elohim, with wisdom, God created the heavens and the earth. Now where does he get the, where did you get the chutzpah to say with wisdom? Rashi's 1,000 years after, approximately 1,000 years after, Rashi's 1090, that was about 100, is he sends us to Proverb number 8 to understand that. And Proverb 8, number 8 says in verse, Rashi sends us to verse number 22, 23, God made me as the beginning of God's ways, before there was the earth, I'm just paraphrasing, or the earth, before there was the heavens, I was present when God formed the orbs of the sky, I was present. The difficulty is it's the first person, who's the I? Because Rashi assumes by the time you get to verse 22, you've read the first 21 verses, and verse 12 says, Ani Chachma, I am wisdom. Not Ani Chacham, not I am wise, I am wisdom. Like I am Yaakov, Yaakov is speaking here, I am wisdom. Wisdom is speaking here. It is a phenomenal, I urge you, Proverb number 8, God made me wisdom as the beginning of God's ways. Before there was the earth, I, wisdom, was present. When God formed the orbs of the sky, I, wisdom, was present. God used wisdom as the substrate for existence. Get that in the beginning. I will still say in my class, in the beginning, God created, but I know it's wrong. Like I'll still say my toes are wiggling, I'm feeling it in my shoes, but I know it's wrong. The text never meant any form of beginning, like it or not, Stone translation, or the Hertz, or the Jerusalem, whatever. It never meant beginning, and if you read it, because Bereshit doesn't work grammatically. The best translation of Genesis chapter 1 is Ba with Bereshit, a first cause, and then in parentheses of wisdom, God created the heavens and the earth. That's why the Jerusalem translation drops with the first, because it says with wisdom. Wisdom is the substrate. With that wisdom, which is completely not physical, God creates a physical world. The substrate of existence is something totally not physical. Now, it's hard to understand how that can be, but it's equally hard to understand how light beams can become physically alive. Where does a light beam have the chutzpah to feel love? But everyone, including Mike Schwerner, the head of the skeptics, accepts the fact that light beams learn love, light beams learn joy, light beams learn to enjoy a high cholesterol steak, right, you know, etc. Even when your wife's not looking. I mean, that's the reality. Light beams became alive. It doesn't make sense. No one has a clue how that happened. No one. Feynman said it perfectly. If anyone tells you they have even a clue of how life, L-I-F-E, started, they're either naive or liars. That's the brilliant Feynman, because no one has a clue. The difficulty is from the beginning. We know numbers, but we have no idea how those numbers come to be. We know an electron jumps from here down to here. It does it in zero time. It has to do it in zero time, otherwise you couldn't get that packet of energy which somehow converts itself into a particle of light called a photon. I mean, how does energy become a particle of light? We know the numbers to 15 decimal places. We have no idea how it happens. And that's everything taking place right now, because electrons jumping back and forth are totally the world that you perceive. And I use the word perceive because you've got to translate. But you should just think it through. The world is completely pitch black and silent. What we perceive as light exists nowhere in the physical universe. What we perceive as sound exists nowhere in the physical universe. We see light waves out here, but they're not light, because guess what? The air's not glowing. And in your brain, you know there's no light. So where's the replay? See, the input is known very well. It's the replay, it's the problem. The same as with sound. The universe is silent. I make this, and there's molecules moving. But the air's not booming. Only when those molecules hit your eardrum do you perceive sound. But there's no sound in your brain. besides gurgle, gurgle, gurgle as the blood goes through your clogged veins. But besides that, there's no sound. The universe is silent and black. That's just the reality. We perceive light. We perceive sound. When the famous statement is a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there, let the whole Knesset be there and it still won't make any sound. Because it doesn't make sound until it comes in your brain, but there's no sound in your brain. Nowhere in the physical universe is what you perceive as light and is what you perceive as sound. That's just
perceive
the reality.
You mean construct?
What?
When you say perceive, you mean construct?
Means perceive. What you perceive as light. I mean perceive. You perceive light, I perceive that I'm seeing you, but I know there's no picture of you putting your hand on your chin. There's neurons taking place. But
you're making it up. You're constructing it.
Yeah, you can. If you want to use the word to construct, I'm not sure, but what construct means. It's getting very late, but soon we want to leave. You pick the people. Unless
Jonathan.
I mean, one thing I want to be this external self.
See what?
The external self or shadow.
Oh, external self. That's lovely. I like that even better. External self.
Whatever. It's purely. It's not physical at all. So it cannot affect ascensions in the brain. It can't cause any stimuli in the brain at all because it's not physical. So I would suggest that just like the brain views everything, all stimuli being external to itself. It knows that
more slowly.
Views all stimuli being external to itself. It views light, sound, whatever. It knows it comes from outside itself. So surely consciousness itself, the brain might assume to be external to itself. Doesn't mean it actually is external to itself.
I can't.
Again, the shadow being cannot produce stimuli since it's not physical.
I'm not sure that's true because if
we're.
I'm not sure you're correct. Because the substrate of those light beams isn't that God was wise to make the universe. God used something called wisdom. No, it does. Because something totally not physical called wisdom. Or physics calls it an idea, or quantum physics, the stuff that makes your iPhone work, he calls it, what is Heisenberg calling? He calls it an idea. And Schrodinger calls it, a thought, and George Wald, the biologist, calls it mind.
So you say wisdom causes stimuli to the brain?
Yeah. Wisdom created your hands going together like that also. Absolutely. Unless the Jerusalem translation is, no, unless Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 is wrong, coupled with Proverbs 8, yeah.
It's the bottom line, the shadow self produces stimuli.
It's more real than the physical universe.
But doesn't sure. stimuli the brain? Does
yes, it actually
stimuli.
Does. Just like wisdom could produce.
Is this like an ESP?
So
I don't know. I'm just saying that.
If it actually affects stimulates parts of the brain, they should be able to produce a machine that measures it.
Tomorrow.
Why?
Because it actually has a physical effect.
But you can't get to the brain. That's the problem. The only antenna that can pick up the mind is the brain.
If it really has a physical effect, a physical effect can be measured.
Really? Show me how wisdom can create a light beam.
Yes, but that's why I somehow doubt this fact about wisdom and
Well, that's the Genesis chapter 1, where the first cause God created the heavens and earth.
I thought you were taking external sources outside the Bible.
I don't think it's circular logic because Proverbs number 8.
I'm
not saying because the Bible says so. I'm saying because physics comes finally to agree with the Bible. The creation.
Why does physics agree with the Bible? Because the Bible says
so. No. George Wald, who starts off his life as an absolute skeptic, says you don't need God. Just give me. Wald gets the Nobel Prize for his work on consciousness. Okay? Another one of the masters of Jews that get it. The Nobel Prize. Wald says you don't need God, just give me enough billions of years. It's one of the few papers by a Nobel laureate that have been retracted. Very few are retracted. That was retracted. And I presume he wanted it retracted because later in his career, he writes the following. This I can tell you. It is if I can't find it, I'm going to kick myself in the head if I can't, but I can't do it. Wald, it's crazy. All these things that I made such nice notes of that I can find. I can't find any. Wald writes like this. I can do it from memory. It has occurred to me lately, and I must confess, these are his words, it has occurred to me lately, and I must confess with some shock at first to my scientific sensibilities. Those are his words, because 10 years earlier he said you don't need any of this stuff. It has occurred to me lately, and I must confess with some shock at first to my scientific sensibilities, that both the question of the origin of life from non-living matter and the origin of consciousness within that life that started from non-living matter can be brought to some degree of congruence. This is with the assumption. This is the assumption that mind, M-I-N-D, mind, has always existed. That mind is the source of the physical world, and it is mind that has given rise to the physical world and has given rise to creatures that can then perform the arts and the sciences and the art. That's the last part of the sentence, is it paraphrase? But this isn't. That it is mind that has given rise to the physical world that produces creatures that can produce the arts and the sciences. I don't know if Wald knows Gornish about what the Bible says. From his writings, he doesn't, okay? But he understands that the deeper he gets into consciousness is exactly what Max Planck, the physicist, says. I regard consciousness as fundamental. Trion, the man that discovered and first published that the universe is the result of a quantum fluctuation, totally virtual, not physical at all, writes that if it is the case that he's correct, then the laws of nature, totally physical, totally abstract, the laws of nature are fundamental, and it's energy and matter that is the offspring of these laws of nature. He says it much better. The one thing I found. But in any event, what it comes out to be is that I don't agree with what you're saying. And I think these persons that work in the field and earn the Nobel Prizes don't agree with what you're saying. That in fact, the total substrate of the world is physical. Sharding, what kind of priest is anyway? But the paleontologist says explicitly, we're not physical beings having a spiritual experience. We're spiritual beings having a physical experience. So in the dualistic world that people said the dualism of Descartes is dead, they're wrong. They're thinking in pre-quantum physics. And that's what the neurologists also talk about. You read their writings, it's all pre-quantum physics.
So Descartes had it right.
But he couldn't prove it. But you read time and again, Descartes' dualism is dead. Really? What about matter and energy? Well, you know, the whole world is dualistic.
Did you have just one last comment?
So you pick whoever you want to be the last comment. Who?
It's difficult
to point because a lot
of people. I accept the honor. Did you ever meet Anthony Flew?
Are you asking the question seriously?
Yes. As you may remember, he was a famous philosopher who espoused atheism all his life, and toward the end of his life reputed atheism and declared that it was based on your writings that he'd come to that conclusion.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I was wondering if there was ever any personal connection.
Oh, yeah, a wonderful man named Roy Varghese, an Asian Indian who lives in Dallas, Texas, in high tech. Thank God in the fullest meaning of the word, I didn't know my works had changed him around, okay? But Roy brought me from Israel and Anthony flew from England, another person from England, mm-hmm. took us to the film school in NYU. Has a great film school in lower Manhattan. He rented the film school for 3 days, brought in these huge platters of kosher food. God bless you, Roy, you're a wonderful human being. I mean, gigantic, because the Lower East Side is great. Anyway, we discussed, it's on, you can see it, there's a video called Has Science Discovered God? I have no financial interest in it, but you can see it on the, you can probably find out how to get it, I don't know. So Roy footed the total bill for that. Yeah, I met him. I didn't know that the books had changed him, but in his obituary, he's quoted in the obituaries in Chicago. Someone sent me the Chicago Times. He died about 10 years ago. In the Chicago Times and also and the New York Times, it says, and Anthony Flew was strongly influenced by Gerald Schroeder, an Orthodox Jewish physicist living in Israel. it was on the New York Times in one of their Sunday, if you know the New York Times, they have a Sunday magazine section, which is huge, and it was on the front page, and there was a 9-page article about that. In that article, they were sure that this guy Schroeder had duped Flew. I mean, my name is mentioned on each page of those pages, 9 times. Mm-hmm. And what can I tell you? I don't think I do fool. He was completely cognizant, and he's in that DVD. And the simple fact is, when you see the data, I see it from the books that I've read. I don't think I'm tricking people. You know, I just show that 6 24-hour days, 24-hour days, kamo sheshet me'avodah, can also be 14 billion years. There's just different perceptions of time. And I mean, that's what we talk about next week, but God willing. But I mean, it's not tricking people. That's the reality. And what do I see? And I will pardon me for saying so, but I will say just one thing about, and I'm saying a lot of things, but having the second book, my second book, The Science, it was on the bestseller's entire year, on Amazon's bestseller's entire year. I'm not bragging, the royalties are just fine. But when you're on the bestseller's for a year, you know what that does? When I send an email to people like Dawkins, or, you know, the real skeptics, they actually answer one or two times, okay? And it never lasts more than two emails back and forth, because then they realize that they don't want to get into this kind of discussion. But now, what was I getting at? But when I speak to them, so they say, you want to call that God, in this proof of God in 5 minutes, you want to call it God? Call it God. We'll just call it the laws of nature. But then their caveat would be, we'll call it God, but it would be a deist God, a God that rounds up the universe and goes off for lunch. Okay? But the Bible, and that could be it, except for the fact the Bible makes, that's what I was saying before, that the Bible makes a prediction that the Jews will stand out. And the Jews stand out. It is completely, completely illogical. Jerry Klein, I meet her from time to time, she lives in Jerusalem. I barely recognize her. Anybody know Jerry Klein? No? No? You know? Okay. She said such a great thing. Just one Saturday, we just bumped into each other verbally, not physically. And she said, I think because Abraham, you know, why Jews stand out? Because Abraham chose God. God decided. God said, I'll make you people. Not just you, but you will stand out, and you'll have all this extra knowledge of understanding the world. Because Abraham, by logic and theory, learned that there'd be a God by looking at the world around his science. And what you point, that may be the reason that Jews stand out. We see that in Psalm 147, where, the very closing lines where God tells, you know, has given us, that we've given it. It doesn't, you know, I don't know if we earned it. I don't think we earned it. We just got it. The Christians always call that blessed, you know.
Okay, one last question. Yeah,
it's not a question. It's kind of summarizing what you said, taking from the first word in the Tanakh, which is Bereshit, as you said before. And it's correct not saying Bereshit means at the beginning. Be Reshit Bara, which means with Reshit.